Okay, guys. So let's get started with Hive, and we will see how this whole Hive stuff goes. And so what all we are going to cover in terms of Hive is, guys, is we are going to cover what Hive is and where to use Hive. Right. So we'll understand, what Hive is, what is the Hive architecture. That's what we are going to understand. And we'll understand also a scenario where we can use that. Then what we will next understand is like why to go for Hive when we have the pig that basically makes our life easier. Then why again we are using Hive. So we'll see the difference between that. And then as I told, like Hive architecture, different components of Hive, little bit background about Hive, like from where it is started, the whole journey of Hive, and how the Facebook uses Hive, like why something became so different in the environment that they came up with this particular tool. So we'll understand that as well. And then we'll see a lot of Hive query language and difference between the normal RDBMS and different types of the data type it supports, and the hands-on exercise. With the help of this particular slide, we'll understand the whole journey of Hive, how it is started. Okay, so the whole journey of this Hive is started from the Facebook. So when Facebook started initially, they had a smaller data set, like few GB of the data. That's where they were getting in 2006. But slowly, all these, Web 2.0, all these, social media kind of the website becoming very popular, they started seeing the flood of the data, which started coming to their, internal server, the data collection server, which they had. So initially, they were using this Oracle kind of the database to capture this database and analyze basically the user behavior, because their whole the Facebook stuff, what you see, it whole service it generates from like what you do on that particular page. So they had this particular requirement where they wanted to capture all the user activity, and based on that they wanted to analyze the data set and then come up with the recommendation or the services for each user. So what they did is, instead of having Oracle, because Oracle was not able to scale in terms of the requirement which they had for the data. So in that particular stuff, they started moving towards having a big data kind of a solution, and that's where the Facebook became one of the early adopter of this whole Hadoop platform. And when they started using this particular Hadoop stack to have the storage of the data, so they faced a couple of challenges while doing that. So they had like huge number of the user base which they were serving, and terabytes of the data per day, and a lot of the SQLs which they wanted to run on top of that, the analysis which they wanted to do, and along with like all these user activity data, they had a lot of unstructured data, like image data as well, people used to upload on the Facebook site. So this was the the challenge what they had in terms of the kind of the data which they were getting, and that's where this whole traditional RDBMS was not suitable kind of storing this data, this kind of the data, and processing such huge volume of the data. And the kind of solution they got to handle this kind of the data set was the the Hadoop MapReduce job. So basically, having Hadoop kind of storage and the MapReduce kind of the processing, they were able to process the huge data set which they were getting from their web logs, and they can now process that with the help of Hadoop. Now, in terms of the technology, Hadoop was a technology like which can store the data and process the huge volume of data in parallel. That's what we understood till now with our interaction with the Hadoop. But then the challenge what it has is, like, you know, for the users is, so they had the people who were very good in terms of the SQL. So they had the people who were very good understanding of, like, how to process the data by writing by a SQL query. But the kind of the data set which they have, that data was available in Hadoop in kind of infrastructure. And if you have to process anything inside Hadoop, it has to happen as a kind of a MapReduce code. So this was kind of, you know, a challenging task for them to basically convert their requirement into the MapReduce job. So it becomes like very hard for them to program directly in the MapReduce, because the skill set what they had for, you know, the people who were expert in, you know, analyzing all this web data is the SQL kind of interface. So that's where what Facebook did is, Facebook analyzed this particular situation, and what they came up with is, like, you know, there is a kind of a gap between the kind of expertise they had and the kind of the tools they have to use to basically do the programming. And that's where they come up with something, a project called Hive. So what the Hive did is, it basically provided a SQL kind of the interface, and by using that, you write your whole processing or whole you know, logic in a SQL construct, and that will get translated into something called a MapReduce job, and that will run on top of Hadoop. So by having this Hive mechanism, what they were able, or Hive tool, what they are able to do is, they are able to match the gap here. So you write your requirement in the SQL, and that get converted inside for Hadoop, it get converted into a MapReduce job with the help of Hive. So that's what, you know, the Hive became a kind of a tool for, you know, using a SQL interface on top of Hadoop. And one interesting thing, guys, this particular challenge, like, so then obvious question will come, like, when we were developing Hive, why Pig came, right? So the reason why you see these two kind of innovation, Hive and the Pig, it basically both happened in-house. So Hive was developed inside Facebook, while Pig was developed at the Yahoo. So when Yahoo was facing this challenge of, like, again, same converting into the MapReduce job, they came up with a language called Pig, and that's what their users were using to convert into the MapReduce job. What Facebook went is more easier approach. They come up with a SQL interface, and then that getting converted into the Hadoop MapReduce. So what you have in Hive is, you have, like, Hive, you can create tables, you can create database. I will show you, like, how to do that. You can, you know, just read the data, you can create partition and the buckets so that you can restructure your data set and you can process that. It has a lot of the schema flexibility, so you can alter the table, you can move the columns, and you don't need to basically reload the whole data set. So all those things easily you can do, all these schema flexibility is there with Hive. Then apart from, like, whatever the Hive offers its own, it also have the plugin custom mapper in the reduce code. So at any point, if you have a requirement to write your own custom code, you can easily write that and integrate with Hive. And the next thing what you have with the Hive is the JDBC ODBC driver. So nowadays, all of these vendors, be it any reporting tool, you know, MicroStrategy, Tableau, like, whichever you are using, they have connectors available to Hive. So by using this JDBC ODBC connection, you can easily, you know, read the data which is available in Hive. Although it's like high latency query, it takes some time to read the data from Hive, but you can read the data from Hive and you can process it, or you can see or visualize the data in your reporting tool, right? And in terms of the table creation in Hive, you can create your table. Like, if your data is stored inside the Hadoop file system, you can just create a Hive table on top of that, and you can start processing the data with the Hive SQL. So that makes your life much easier. You don't need to basically go through a lot of the load process and all as you have in the normal ETL. You can refer the data, and you can start using that. And apart from that, Hive also supports a different kind of the formats. Like, it has the RC format table. You can store the data in sequence file, right? So all those kind of the, you know, there are different, you know, the optimization kind of stuff you can do with the Hive in terms of storing the data and processing with the help of Hive query language. So this is the example, guys. Again, like, so in Hadoop, one thing what you have to understand is, like, you have the multiple way to do the same thing inside Hadoop. You decide, like, which particular tool or which particular approach you want to do based on the your comfort level, based on the expertise which you have, and as per that you will start processing your data inside Hadoop with that particular tool. So as we can see this healthcare example, it can be done as the Java MapReduce code. You can write directly a Java code, you can do that. You can do this in Pig, you can process that, or you can use this Hive interface again with the Hive as well. You can read the data in Hive table, do all this, you know, de-identification or encryption of the data you want, and you can store it inside the Hadoop file system. So what the Hive is? Hive is basically a data warehousing package that's built on top of Hadoop. So you get a kind of, you know, all this data warehousing function. You can create a database, you can create table, you can create view, you can read the data. So all those kind of, you know, operation you can do with on top of Hive. And mainly used for the data analysis. So people who are from the SQL background, business analyst, your data analyst, so they prefer to go with Hive because you can easily use the existing SQL expertise to start interacting with Hive. And mainly targeted towards the user who are more comfortable with the SQL kind of interface, so they can easily use that. And similar to kind of the SQL and call, it's generally like you have the SQL, it supports you know, a lot of functionality. In case of Hive, it's not everything what you have in the SQL it supports in Hive query language, but it has good compatibility with like what the SQL interface you have. And generally used for managing and querying the structured data. So this is like one of the important thing you have to understand with the Hive, because Hive may look easier to you, but then it has one of the kind of the constant. And that's generally like it can process only the structured data. If your data is unstructured data or semi-structured data, you will not be able to process with the help of Hive. Okay. Then the other thing what it does, it basically hides the complexity on top of Hadoop. So now you are not writing the code directly with the help of the MapReduce, but you are writing in something, the language which you are familiar with, the SQL kind of the language, and then that gets converted into the Hadoop MapReduce job. And as per the history of this Hive, so it was developed at the Facebook. So as you can see, it was developed at the Facebook, and they contributed it back to the Apache open source. And it's one of the, you know, the tool that's widely used inside the Hadoop stack for, you know, accessing the data, analyzing the data. And as the Facebook was the, you know, the main contributor for this particular whole project, Facebook claims that they analyze like there are several terabytes of the data every day with the help of the Hive interface. So that's the kind of, you know, the uses of Hive and the kind of the background you have for the Hive, how it is started. Okay. So now let's look something more about the Hive, right? And when I'm telling about Hive, although it looks very promising in terms of the interface it provides you to process the data, but then it has some kind of limitation as well. So one of the thing is structured data. Then the next thing what I will tell you that what Hive is not, you will understand like what Hive cannot do that. So let's first understand like what all Hive is, right? So the Hive is, it's a kind of the data warehouse infrastructure. You create database, table, view, and then you access the data. So that's the kind of the interface it provides you on top of Hadoop. Easy way to basically enable ETL kind of operation. So you can easily aggregate your data, summarize your data as you do in normal ETL processing. Now with the Hive, you can do that. Okay. Then what you have to interact with the Hive is a SQL kind of the interface. So that's like most of the people are familiar with that, so that you can use it to basically analyze the data and interact with your data. And apart from whatever it offers as part of the native form of Hive, it also allows the programmer to basically plug in the custom mapper and the reducer code. So with the help of, you know, your custom map and the reduce code, you can basically always enhance this whole Hive functionality in terms of, you know, the processing or to meeting any kind of a particular business requirement which you have. So where all you can use Hive? So as like one of the thing, Hive is generally suitable for the structured data. So whenever you have a structured data set, you can easily use Hive for that. So like if you have the log and if you want to process that, you can do that. If you have any kind of the the customer facing BI solution, like where user can tell, okay, can you run this particular SQL and give me the count of these users in this particular geo? The next requirement is going to do, can you tell me like what all the the top 10 customer in this particular product category, right? So all those customer facing kind of the business intelligence you can easily do with the help of the Hive. You will be, once you expose your data with the help of Hive, you can easily write SQL and query that. Any kind of the data mining, if you want to do that, you can use that as well, right? So you can analyze your huge data set with the help of the Hive SQL. Any kind of the indexing you want to build, any kind of the predictive modeling where you want to fetch the data. So for all these purposes, you can use Hive to basically select the data and feed it to the other algorithm which it has. So now, why to go for Hive when Pig is there, right? So that's like one question what you might be getting, right? When we saw something similar kind of the feature, now why we are talking about Hive, right? So when you talk about Hive, it generally exposes your data with in form of the SQL. So anytime if you have to provide this kind of the SQL interface, you can use Hive because your data can be represented in table in the column format. When it comes to the Pig, it provides something similar, like you can declare like what you want to do and then Pig will be able to do, but you will never be able to access the Pig data set in terms of a table or writing a SQL. So it will be always direct interaction with the files where the data is getting stored or file where the data is getting read. Right? And generally the Pig is preferred by the programmers and the researcher who likes to do all the programming stuff and do the stuff their own. While in case of the Hive, it generally used by the analyst, which can who can easily analyze the data with the help of Hive. Now, compared to Hive and Pig, if you want to have the more understanding, so let's see some few more features with Hive and the Pig. So one is Hive, it provides you the SQL kind of the interface, so that's what you have the SQL kind of look and feel when you interact with the Hive. But while in case of Pig, what you have is you have a kind of a Pig Latin language, and that's where you write your code and interact with the Pig compiler, and then it converts the whole your program into MapReduce job. In case of the Hive schema, yes, you have to provide the schema how you want to read the data set. Until you provide the schema, it will not be able to read the data. So you have to do this create table, give the schema, then load the data inside that. In case of the Pig, what you have is it's basically the implicit, guys. So if you want to give the schema, you can use this as keyword and you can give the schema. But if you don't want to use the schema, you can leave it as it is, and then with the dollar notation, you can always access Pig. In case of Hive, I will show you like what is partitioning. So Hive supports partitioning, so you can get basically you can do some tuning in terms of the processing of the data set and it will be faster. While in case of the Pig, there is no the partition as such, so you store either all the data set to an output directory. Pig has a support of the thrift, so by using this thrift API call, you can query this Hive meta store, and you can see all the details about this the Hive tables and all from this thrift API call. In terms of the UDF, user defined function, both of them support, and most of these UDFs will be in Java, so that's what they support. Serialization and deserialization, both Hive and the Pig supports the serialization and deserialization. DFS direct access, yes, you can read the data directly from the Hive as well as the Pig. You can both, the data set can be stored inside the Hadoop file system, it can be there. In terms of the shell, you have this both Hive and the Pig shell, so both have their own interactive shell which you can use it to interact with the data set which you have. And both have this streaming support as well, and the interface, Hive has a web interface where you can see the data set, see the table, all those kind of stuff, but then Pig doesn't have any such interface. In terms of JDBC ODBC connectivity, in Hive, yes, you have this ODBC connectivity, but in case Pig, it will just write the data inside the output file, and then you have to move that file with the help of whatever tool you have and then integrate it. So let's see some quick architecture stuff like Hive, how it looks and how it processes the data set. So in case of the Hive, your data is going to be stored inside the Hadoop file system, right? So that's the location where your data will be either stored or you're going to store as part of your Hive table load. And the reason why you store your data inside the Hadoop file system, because that's the place you get basically the reliability and the scalability stuff. So by using this Hadoop file system, you will be able to have all these multiple copy of the data that you can replicate across the server and you can consume that. So that's what the HDFS offers. In terms of the Hive, so that's about the storage of the data part. And then what you have is you have the something called the meta store. So what the meta store means is whenever you create a Hive table or create a database or the view, all those definition about the data set, the database which you have created, the table you have created, all those things will be stored inside something called the meta store. And on top of this meta store only, you have this Thrift API call running, and that basically enables you to do browse query with the help of the JDBC and ODBC connectivity. So your all table definition, column definition, database, everything will be stored in something called the meta store. Now, when it comes to the meta store, you can implement meta store in different way. We are going to see a slide for that. For our lab example, what we are doing. So generally, with the Hadoop installation, what you have is for Hive, there is a Derby database. So that's where your meta store will be stored. But you can take that out and you can start, putting your data on a MySQL and other kind of the database as well. The challenge what you will have with the Derby database, guys, is it's limited to one user only. So at one point, if you have moved the data, only one shell you can open, and then you can interact with that. Apart from that, what you have is like all these user-defined function support. So it supports all these MapReduce script. You can integrate that. All these, the UDF function, string, sum, average, those kind of things you can do. If you want to basically read serialization and deserialization data, all those kind of the data set it can support. It can support all these comma separated file, regular expression, all those kind of the processing you can do with the Hive. Then in terms of the storage, what a Hive has, it supports text file. Like you can store your backend data in the text file itself, so you can read the data set. If you want to store your data as a sequence file, you can do that as well. If you want to store data in RC file, so RC file is basically, guys, a columnar way to store the data inside the Hive. So if you are using just selective columns in the rest of the Hive processing, you can define your Hive table in such a way that it will store the data into the RC file format. Okay, so the different components which we have for Hive. So we have one thing is we have is Hive shell. So by using the Hive shell, only we are going to interact like how the Hive create tables and all this stuff. Then you have the Hive meta store. So what the meta store does is it stores the metadata about the Hive. So all it will have is the table definition, view definition, database definition, all those kind of things will be stored in the meta store. Then you have the Hive cell, we talk like where we submit the query. Then you have something called the driver. So with the help of the Hive driver, it will take your code and it will convert into the into something which Hadoop can understand in terms of execution. And then you have the Hive compiler, execution engine, optimizer. So all these basically whenever you submit your query, all these steps go to this the compilation execution, and then finally you will have the output that will be basically a MapReduce job that you will be running inside the Hadoop cluster. So as I was telling about the metastore, guys, so you have the option like you can use the embedded metastore. So whenever you install Hive, it also comes with a metastore. So if you want to use that, so that particular metastore is in Derby, and that's what the metastore we have in our virtual machine as well. So with the help of this meta store, you will be able to store all your the database and table, all the definition, right, all those things you can store in this particular meta store. Now when it comes to like going beyond the Derby, because in the Derby you can have only one command line interface, and that's what you can run. So in case if you want to have more, you have to go with the MySQL. When it comes to MySQL, you can store locally on the machine wherever the Hive is running, or you can run on the remote machine as well and then provide that connectivity to that MetaStore. So now we talked about Hive. We see that Hive can, you know, do a lot of good thing in terms of giving SQL interface and all. But then there are certain limitations as well we have with Hive, right? And which Hive cannot do that. So let's try to understand that as well, and then we'll basically switch over to see some, you know, more concept, and then basically the Hive hands-on kind of stuff. So limitation of the Hive. In Hive, there is no selective update and delete kind of operation. So like if you talk about the normal Oracle or the SQL interface, where you insert the data, you update the data and delete the data based on the row key. In case of the Hive, that's not the kind of the requirement. So if you have like any selective update or delete to be performed, that particular stuff you cannot do with the help of the Hive. Then the other thing is like when it comes to the Hive performance, I don't want to basically oversell Hive. What I am trying to tell you is Hive is good in terms of the SQL kind of interface which it provides, but then it's not good for low latency kind of security, because it has its own process to convert your job, run the MapReduce job, and then get the output. So that particular stuff, it takes time, and it's not very the faster kind of a process. That's what we have. And it has the latency for the Hive queries is generally very high, so you will get basically high kind of the latency whenever you are interacting with the Hive data set. And since it doesn't provide the selective update or the insert, so it is not basically designed for any kind of the online transaction processing kind of systems. Now, what all you can do with the Hive guys, or with the Hive query language? With the Hive, you will be able to filter the data, like it suppose all these where clause and all. So with this, you will be able to filter the data. You will be able to join the data set. So some of all these things, I will show you guys in Hive hands-on as well. So you can store your data into a Hadoop file system. Like from the Hive table, if you run certain SQL and you want to store in Hadoop, you can do that. And it also supports something called the partitioning, guys. So with the help of the partitioning, what you will see is it basically speed up the process of how you read the data and consume the data. So if the person who is responsible for creating the table, if know that how that this table is getting to be created, you can basically partition the table, and based on that, it will be able to be just read that particular subset of the data. Yeah, and also in Hive, like you can read the data set from one table and be able to move the data to other table as well. So you can do create a table as select, and then it will be able to do that. So so before I go further, guys, there are a couple of more slides as well, and then we have the data model partitioning and bucketing. So at this point, guys, shall we switch over to the hands-on stuff? Let's see how to interact with the Hive, how it stores the data, what is the structure, and then come back and see like what is partitioning, what is bucketing, and then with that one, right? So control them. Let me close this. Okay. So I'm going to show you guys how to use Hive and how to interact with Hive. So that's what I'm going to tell you. Let me, before I start, let me share you something which is important for you in terms of Hive installations. So if you have this cloud era virtual machine, which most of you have installed, so on that particular stuff, Hive is already set up, so it's available. And what you have to do here is you have to just do a very, very basic setup there. So what you have to do is to do the Hive setup on the Clara, you have to create a folder on your desktop, that like our desktop or anywhere else, wherever you want, you can create a simple folder. And then what you do is you take the path of the folder which you have created, and then you do a simple sudo su, and then sudo basically becoming a root kind of the user here in Linux. So you do people who are not familiar with the Linux. So you do sudo su, and then if it asks password, give the cloud era the password. And then once you are there, you go inside this home cloud era, because that's where you will go. And then you have to change your directory to user live hive conf. So that's where you will find a file called hive-side.xml. So you have to open this particular file. And how you open that? You do since you need elevated password, so that's what you use sudo gedit hive-side.xml. And once you open that, you will find a property, connection URL. And in that, what you have to do is, after this database name, whatever the folder you have created till this much, you have to replace it. So you have to put it like home, whatever cloud or desktop or in your folder, wherever you create this whole path of the folder you have to give. And leave all this stuff meta store db create true value as it is. Once you do that, all you have to do is, that's the only change you have to do here, guys. So after this database name, you have to just give the path where you have created this particular folder, right? Once you do that, save this stuff, and once you save that, you just come out from here, and then you start this whole stuff with the help of the sudo hive. So always you have to start with the sudo hive, and that's what it is going to work. At any point, if you do the sudo hive and the command prompt doesn't work, or if you get any issue, no need to be panic on the virtual machine. All you have to do is create another folder, and that's replace that path in this particular file hive-side.xml, right? Your hive will start working. Okay, so that's the only small setup you have to do that, and this document is available. If you log into your learning management system, you will be able to find this particular stuff available inside the tab which we have, right? So there you can easily find this stuff, and then you can download that. So no need to basically do the hands-on, guys, as I'm doing here. All I wanted to show you is you can do this stuff before you start with the Hive. Okay, so that was about the Hive setup. I'll come back to the slide where we left. So before we start with the hands-on, let's just quickly see about the kind of namespace it supports, and then we'll get started with Hive. So in case of Hive, like whenever you load the data inside Hive, so in Hive you will see the loading of the data will be very fast, right? So it makes basically what it does is like whenever want to write the data inside Hive, so whenever you have to perform the load, it will just take the data set and move the data inside Hive namespace. So that way the initial load is very, very fast. While it comes to the processing of the data, it takes a certain time because it convert into the map reduce and all. So that's where it takes time to do that. And when it comes to doing any update or any kind of transaction, so all those stuff, it is not supported in Hive because it cannot do the selective update and insert on a data set. In case of the Hive data type, what all we have? So what all we have is like you have all this Boolean data type, you have int, small int, big int. So all these kind of the data type is supported with Hive. Apart from that, you don't have here the char array, guys, where you define like what var char kind of thing normal in the database. So what you can do is in case of Hive, you can always define that as a string, like if you have to define, and then it will be able to do that. In case of floating data or the decimal data you have, you can define float and double. So these are the basic data type we have. Then in Hive, what it does is it also supports the complex data type that's called basically the struct, map, and the array. So what you have is like if you have like data set, like you want to store name, address, location, all those things will be you can store, like you can define a structure and you can store that. Similarly, the map, the key value pair, you can do. You can have the list of the array elements you can store as part of a Hive column. So that way, what you can do is you basically differ from like how the normal RDBMS have. So in normal RDBMS, you generally keep the schema very normalized. But in case of Hive, you can see that since you can store array struct, you basically don't restrict your always the data set should be in a normalized form, right? So other thing what you have with the Hive guys is the Hive namespace. So basically whenever you want to store the data inside Hive, so you have the two stuff. You can create a database, and then inside the database whatever table you create, it will be stored. Other way is like you leave it everything in the default, so that's the default database have and where your table will get created. So initially when you start Hive, you leave everything in default. Slowly once you become experienced user of Hive, you may start playing in your database and then you do that. So what that basically database does is it creates a namespace for you, and then whatever the thing you do inside the database, it will be like if you have the table A in one database, you can create the same table A in another database. But inside one database, you cannot create the again two. So that's like normal how the other RDBMS support. Then apart from that, Hive also had the support for partitioning and the bucketing. And to understand the partitioning and the bucketing, you will need to understand like how Hive stores the data and how process the data. Okay. So now at this point, we will switch over to the hands-on stuff, and then we'll see how to work with Hive. Okay, so let's do a PWD. It's 26th batch. Let's go. Okay, we are here. If we do ls minus l. Okay, so let me create a directory called mkdir and vehicle Hive underscore demo. Now let's go inside this. Okay, now let me come here. Is this the shell we are working on? Okay, yeah. So I don't need pig, so let me quit from here. Okay, control L. Oh, no. Give me a second, guys. Okay. Now what we are going to do is we are going to start the Hive shell. So how you start the Hive shell? You do a simple step, sudo Hive, and with this it will ask for the password. It should not ask, but let me see. Sometimes it doesn't work as correctly. Okay. So tables. If this command works, then you can think that Hive is working correctly. Sometimes it doesn't. So, okay, so it works. So it's working correctly. Okay. So now I will show you. So how to start the Hive? Sudo Hive. Once you do this Hive, you get a Hive shell, and that's where we are going to do the rest of it. Any point you want to clear the screen, you do control L. Things will be clear. Okay. So now let me do one thing. So databases. We have a database. Okay, we have a couple of databases. Okay, control L. So now let's go ahead and learn, guys, how to create our own database. Okay, so I do have some of the database which I have done for the other class, so that's why it is existing here. But in case once you will go and repeat this exercise, you will see there will be no database, so you may not get any database apart from the default database we have in the database. So what we'll learn is first like how to create a database in Hadoop. So Hive, right? So you do create database. Okay, so let me pick this data name, telecom. So we are going to create a database called telecom. Okay, so how you create the database? Create database and telecom, all the Hive commands you have to terminate with the colon. So that's why you have to do that. So you terminate it with the colon. Okay. Once you return your Hive cell again with, you know, gracefully, what it means that this particular command executed successfully. So now you have your database created. This is one way to create that, right? So once you create that, what you can do is you can run again the show database command, and you should be able to see this database. So if you go back and write show databases, you will be able to see the database which you created now, telecom. Ignore the all other database we have, guys. All these database we created for the other class. Okay. This is something called the default database, so that you need to pay attention. So in case if you don't is create your own database, all your table will get created inside the default database. So that's what we have, the default. So now you have this database created called telecom. Now what you can do is you can go ahead and, you know, start creating a table inside this. So you can create a table, and then you know, that particular table will get created in the database. So I will show you like how you do that. Let me show you one more thing. Like, suppose if you want to create a database like telecom, something like, you know, like, you know, a telecom DB2, something like that, where you want to create, right? Now whenever you create, you may have like this may be a telecom backup database, right? Something like that you can have. So now if you want to add a certain kind of, you know, things, right? So that tomorrow if you want to see this data set, you want to know like what kind of the database it is. So you can add comment as well. Normal, in case if you have done DB activity, you will, you know, right? Holds something backup data. Okay, something like that you can give it. It's great, right? So now if you do show databases, you will see two databases, telecom and telecom underscore backup. So you can add the comment as well, so that next time whenever you are reading the data set, you can undo that. Now you know, the multiple things you can do, guys. I'm not sure how much admin kind of activity you will like. You can add the DB properties as well, where you can say who is the creator, what date you are creating. So all those kind of the stuff you can, you know, add that, right? So, like if I tell you, right, create telecom backup extended something, okay, and then you can basically remove the comment. So you can do create a database. So we are creating a database called telecom backup extended with, you can add something called DB. And then here you can add like who is the creator. You can add like, okay, you can give something date, maybe something like 18-10-2014. Whatever you want to give, right? You can add these kind of stuff as well. Okay. Just a second, guys. Should be going. What's the problem? Yeah, create database telecom with DB properties. Creator. Okay, something going wrong here, guys. I'm just trying to, is typing a type error here. Okay, this I didn't. Okay, I got it, guys. Okay, so it's done now. Okay, yeah, got around that. Thanks, Vala. Yeah. So you can add this kind of stuff as well, so that next time when you come and try to read this one, you can do that. Right. Now if you want to see about the database, what you can do is you can do something called describe, and then you can give describe database, and you can give extended, so you can see all the details, and like you can give this one. terminate with the column. You can see all the details which you provided. This is the telecom database where it got created, and then these are the details which you added here. Okay, if you want to see the about the backup, you can see that as well. You know, whatever the comment you added holds backup data there, and then this database that's got created. Okay, if you do the extended, it will show you all the information related to the database. So that's the way how you create the database inside Hive. Everybody will be able to do that simple command, create database. Let me show you the simple one, database and the database name. No need to add comment, guys. Just do create database telecom, it should be good. I hope most of you should be able to do this. Okay, oh, it says yes. Okay, okay. Now, once you have your database created, let's learn now like how to create a table inside this database. So, let's create a simple table here that will basically store the two data set, and I will basically show you how to you know, store a data inside this Hive table with this particular example, right? So now, if you want to create a table, what you have to do is on the command prompt itself, you can give your structure like what you want to create, and based on that, it will go ahead and create the table, and then you have to load the data inside this one. So okay. So now, suppose if you want to create your database inside this particular table, your create table inside this particular database called telecom. So for that, what you have to do on the command cell, you have to tell that I'm going to work in this data set. So you tell use telecom. Once you do this, after that, whatever the table you will create, all those tables will get created inside this particular database. So let's go ahead and create a table. So you do create. So what kind of table you guys like to work? Okay, so let me see from the name itself. So telecom, what kind of the table you guys use generally, right? Maybe call records. Okay, something I will add, create table and call. Okay, recharge. Okay, let me create a table called recharge. That's better. So this is the table I'm creating. I'm just creating a small table here, guys. And you can have an opening bracket. So that will basically tell that, okay, now you are going to give the schema of the table, what the table is. So I think the first column may be the cell number, right? And that's going to be an integer. Okay. Then maybe the second one I will take as a very simple geo or city. And then I am take that as a string, okay. And then you have something called name, and that also I am taking as a string. So you have to provide a schema for your table, okay. Now what we have done till now, create, as of our table not created, we didn't hit enter, so command prompt not started. I am just like create table, we are creating table recharge. Where this table is getting created, guys? This table is getting created inside this particular database called telecom, because we have told on the Hive shell to use telecom, and now we are inside this database and we are creating the table. So we do create a table recharge, then we give the column name and the data type, city and the data type, name and the data type. Once you are done with that, you have to specify what will be the schema of the data you read. Now, when it comes to schema, all we know that in Hive, you can only process the structured data. So once you have the structured data, you have to provide what kind of the schema it is going to use. So for that, what you do is you write something like row format delimited fields terminated by, and then you do something like comma, okay, and that's all. You hit enter, your table will be created, right? So that's the way how you create a table inside a database. Now, once you do show tables, it will show you the table inside this database called Recharge. There is a, inside this database called Telecom, you have a table got created called Recharge. Are you guys with me till now? It should be simple to understand, guys. I don't think there is any complexity. Okay. So now, once you are able to create a database, once you are able to create table, the next thing is like how to load the data inside this. Okay. So that's what next. So for that, let's first go ahead and create a data set here. So let's do gedit and go ahead and insert the data in this table. So recharge is the table name. Okay. Gedit. There is no similar to the recharge again. You can have anything recharge dot input. I will just take it. Okay. Now inside this, I have to add a certain you know, the detail, the fields which will it will read it and insert that. So let me have that type. You can have 999 as one number. Then it can be something India, and then it can be something name ABC. Okay, then you can have 689 as another number. Then you can have USA, and then you can have name it MNB. Okay, then you can have 9087 something okay, some name. Okay, save it, close it. So now what we did it, we created a data set, and that particular data set is basically is the input file which we have. If you do cat of this file, you will see the data file that is separated by the comma. So generally the process will be like this kind of Hive. You will generally have this data set first, and one based on this data set you will be able to create a table on top of that. So based on the table, the data set delimiter, you will define what kind of the delimiter you will use to basically store the data inside this. So row format delimiter, field separated by comma. Okay. So now next we are going to learn is like how to load the data inside this particular table. So as of now, if I do a select a star here, select a star recharge, star from recharge, you will not see anything here. Okay, zero. Now let's go ahead and load the data inside this. So loading the data, what you do is you do it something like load. So you can load the data from both SDFS and the local file system. As of now, since we have created in the local file system, so from there only I will tell you like what it's how the data is getting loaded from there. So load data, you do local, and then you do in path. So load data, local, in path. And then you specify the data set which you want to load. So in our case, Hive demo. And then you take recharge.input. This is the data set we want to load. And the, from where you want to load? Into table called recharge. What we are doing, we are trying to load now some data set inside. Load the data local in path, and then you give the path where it is, and then into table called recharge. You hit enter now. It says the data has been loaded. How to verify that? Just go back, select a star from the recharge. You should be able to see the data here. This 999 India ABC, USA UK, right? So this is the way how you load the data. You create table, then you have a data set. So data set will be available here, or you whichever folder you have, then you based on the schema, you specify the schema here, field terminated. Then you do something called load data local in path, give the path of the input data set into table called recharge, whichever table you have created. It will load the data, and once you load the data, do a quick testing here, do a select star, and you should be able to see the data set which is stored here. Is it clear? Will you guys be able to create the table, load the data inside Hive? Okay. Now, next, let me show you what happens in the background whenever you create a table, right? So, to understand that, what you have to do is whenever you create a table, you can see the details about the table, like what kind of the table it created, where it got created, right? So all those things you can see again with the describe command. So you can do describe, and then you can do this particular table name. You will see some details like what is the schema of the table that you can see that. Now what you can do is you can do describe extended. Once you do that, it will show you all the details about the table name, database name, owner, what time it was created, all those stuff it will show. The thing which you have to pay attention is this particular stuff, the location where this database got created, and that's on the local machine which we are referring here. You have this user Hive warehouse and telecom. So this is the location which you have to pay attention in terms of accessing this particular database. So now you come here, Control L and Control CD. Now if you do Hadoop fs hyphen ls, okay, I think we have to copy .dbs. So whenever you create a database inside Hive, what happens is it has this particular structure, guys. It's a folder structure that gets created. So it will create a folder called user Hive warehouse that's already existing. Inside that, whenever you create a database, it will create a folder inside this database. Whenever you create a table inside that database, it will go ahead and create a table inside that particular database. So that's where it will be able to maintain the namespace in case of Hive. Now next you create another database, so that will be basically stored in user Hive warehouse and telecom 2.db, and then whatever the table you have, that's altogether separate from the what you have in this particular database. Okay, so now once we are good with this one, right, let's move on towards one more concept, right? So this is something we call it managed table. So where you create a table, that ownership of the data, okay, it goes with the Hive and it keeps that. Then there is a concept of something called the external table. What you do with the external table is, like, you create a table, but you don't directly load the data inside the table. All you do is you create a reference for that particular data set. Based on that, data will get exposed to the particular, the external table. Okay. So now, let me show you one more stuff, guys. If I go back here and if I come back here, create, is this there? Recharge to. Let me see if I can quickly get it. No. Okay, so you can have this in number int. I can just go ahead and pick from a city or the string. No, it's not going to work, guys, because it has to be created an external table. Can we use same data for two different tables? Yes, you can use that. Okay. So create table, recharge to cell number int, okay, this one. And then all you have to do is you have to give this row format delimited, filter delimited by comma. Now, before I go ahead and create that, I want to you guys to pay attention to this particular location, guys, which I want to show you. So where that command went. Yep. Okay. So now see here, guys, this is the Hadoop fs hyphen ls. This is the inside this one it is. Okay, find telecom underscore db. You have some file, some table that got created, and then that table will have this data set. Now, if I go back and create this particular table stuff, create table recharge 2, what you will see that there will be some change inside this particular location. Inside this, what do you guys think the it will do, guys, when I create a database called telecom2 or backup, right? It is basically going to add a separate folder here. Okay, so now if you go back and do this, okay, let me bring this command here only. See, here is the namespace for recharge. This is the namespace for recharge 2. So that's where the data gets, that's where the the structure gets created whenever you are dealing with the Hive tuber. Now, if you want to load the data again, you can take the same data set, give all these parameters, and it will be able to load the data into that table. When it will load the data, what it will do is it will create a copy of the file which it is basically processing. So what it will do is now if you try to load the same data set here, so let me go back. Okay, so now instead of this one, into we'll do it in recharge 2. Okay, now once you do this, what you will see here is inside this particular folder there will be one more file that will get come. Okay, so you have db recharge 2 and inside this particular stuff that input file that got created here. So now what we are going to do is we are going to create an external table, and that will basically not having the ownership of the data. So what it means is it will refer to a location, and from that location it will be able to read the data and store it, or to show it as a table in the column format. So that's what we are going to do it with the help of the external table concept. So now let's go ahead and create an external table. So how you create external table, guys? It's again a simple process. So here we used create table and then we created that. Now instead of that, what we'll do is create table. Let's take this one. Let me clean this. Okay. Instead of recharge, we'll create a table called external. Then in this time let's give it something called external exchange, something called a string, maybe volume. Okay, we didn't do that. It will not work, guys. It's not going to work. Let me fail it. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to create external table. You have to do create external table. Okay. Create external table, and then you give this name, recharge underscore external. Okay. Now you give all this schema, whatever you want, exchange string. So there is a slight difference between the external table, internal table, and the managed table, guys. So I'm going to show you with this, fold creation. Okay.
name as string, and then row format. Okay. So what we are going to do is we are going to create an external table, and we are telling that we are going to create a table called recharge underscore external. The schema is similar, and we are basically going to give the location of the table where the data is. So this is where it can read directly from the HDFS. So let me go ahead and create, I think, a string int and a string. Okay, so let's do gedit external.txt string name, or maybe abc, then int 123, the string rtva. Okay, so this is a simple data set which I have created, and we will move this data set inside Hadoop, and then we'll see how this particular stuff will be available for us to process. Okay, so if I do ls-lrt, it should be the external.txt. Let's create a folder structure, Hadoop fs hyphen ls. Now, if I move this dataset, Hadoop fs hyphen put. No, I have to create a dataset for mkdir. Okay, so we have moved this data set. So now this is the location we will give to our Hive table. So this is the location from where it has to read the data. So now what you can think of, guys, is this location will be like coming from your, like, you have the upstream job, that the MapReduce job, that basically writing the data, and then rest of the consumption of the data you can do with the help of the Hive table. So now if you do select star from recharge external, you will be able to see the data. So in this case, we didn't run the load statement. All we did is, like, whatever the data is available inside HDFS, we took that data and we just linked it here with the keyword called location, and the data is available inside this table called recharge underscore external. Now, let's see what happened in the backend when I created this table. Did it read the data directly from the location we gave, or it has created a copy of that one? So that one, how you can do that? You can come back here and same command, we will go and see our database side what it has done. Okay, so let's go ahead, telecom.db. This is the data set we created. You see here, there is only two tables called recharge and recharge to. There was no folder that's got created for this particular stuff called recharge underscore external, and the reason for that is because it doesn't store or doesn't own any data set. All it does is it refer a data set that is available on this particular location. Once the data is available there, with the help of the external table, what it can do is it can just read or reference the data, and whatever the processing you want to do, you can do on top of the data. The thing is, like, in case if you drop that particular external table, your data will still be remain safe inside the HDFS. But if you have created a managed table, if you have moved your data inside the, that particular managed table, then if you drop the table, your database will, the table structure will also will get deleted, and your that's from the meta store, and then your data will be also lost from the Hadoop file system.
So there is no need to load all the data into Hive. In case you are creating the external table, yeah, there may not be need. Okay. Now, once you create the external table, all it does, guys, is it creates a metadata in Hive. It knows where to read the data, but it doesn't have any ownership of the data which it has created. Okay. So now, to tell you like what the ownership, I have to basically delete these two tables, and then only you will be able to, you know, get that. So now you have this telecom underscore DB that's got created, and inside that you have full record recharge and recharge underscore 2. Now what we are going to do is we are going to drop this particular table recharge. Let's see what will happen to the database we have here. And which table you guys want to delete, guys? We have recharge underscore external, and then we have recharge 2. Which table you guys want to drop it? So this table is managed table. This table is external table. Okay. So let's first go ahead and delete the managed table. So you do something called drop table. Yeah, one more thing, guys, if you are not sure like what you are doing, you can always use if not exist. Drop table. This is anyhow external table. Let's first go ahead and delete any internal table. Okay. What we are doing, drop table and recharge. Once we do that, what you will see here is all this folder, it will get deleted. Recharge 2, after that, whatever we have inside that, it will get deleted. So we'll come back to that. Let's go back here. Okay. Now if you do you will see only recharge, there is no recharge too. Okay. So that's the way the managed table, whenever you drop the data. Drop the table, your data will also get deleted. So that's what you have to be careful with the managed table. Now, in case of external table which you have created, right? So if you do a drop of this one, it's not going to do anything, to you. So it will just go ahead and, okay, drop table. Okay, so now the table has been dropped. Even though your data, whichever you provided here, if you do Control L, if you do Hadoop FS -LS, your data is still remain intact here at external.txt. Okay, so this is the difference between, guys, the managed table and the external table, where external table takes the ownership of the data. While managed table, managed table take the ownership of the data. While in external table, you just refer the data, it doesn't take the ownership in terms of, dropping the data set. Okay. Are we good with like a storage part, guys? How to create the table, drop the table, external, internal. Is this thing clear? So now whenever I tell a table getting created in Hive, you understand that inside database, one folder getting created. Right, so that's the way how that the tables are stored inside Hive. One good thing with this particular tool, guys, what you have is like if you want to learn all the database kind of activity you can do with Hive, you have everything available on your virtual machine, which you can use it to do that. Okay, so now we are good in terms of understanding about getting table created, getting the data inside this, loading the data, and then we are next going to see some more concept related to Hive. So now if we understand this, we should be able to understand the rest of this partitioning and the bucketing stuff. Apart from this creating the data set and loading inside the external table, and as you see, like when you drop the table, it basically maintain you the data whichever you have stored inside the SDFS location, the data remains stored. Now the next thing is about like when you try to read the data from the Hive table, it will always be it will get converted into the MapReduce job, and then only it will be able to process that. Okay, so we do have this particular stuff. Now let me clear this. Now if you do select count, now, whenever you do any kind of the processing in Hive, the reason why I'm showing you guys is, now I did a simple select count star from the jar. So all it has to do is it has to count how many number of the records it has. To count that, what it's using is, it's using the MapReduce, and that's it's using internally. We are not specifying anything, so it's automatically just starting that, and it's telling you that it's having three number of the records, right? So that's the way Hive internally start the MapReduce job and do the processing on behalf of you. So always you have to see the location where the data is it is referring, and from the location you will basically look for the the file which is getting delivered there, and based on that you will know this the schema of the external table. Yeah, so now it has completed and we have the records here. Okay. So one thing you can notice from here, guys, is whenever you create a Hive table and you start interacting with the Hive table, you may find it very slow for the smaller dataset. Like if you just see about counting the three dataset, it took certain amount of time to basically get that. But when we talk about the today's the normal other RDBMS what we have, they are much faster in terms of processing this data set, and they can able to do that. But when you scale that particular database with the large volume of the data, you will see that although it has some overhead in terms of starting this MapReduce and getting the count, but then it will be able to scale much better than the normal RDBMS kind of stuff. So we saw what is Hive, where to use Hive. So basically for the structured data, why to go with Hive when Pig is there. So we saw the Hive architecture, we saw the Hive component, we understood about the Hive background, why Facebook has to develop that. And then we also understand about the certain limitation of the Hive, like a Hive cannot process unstructured data, Hive cannot provide you the selective update and delete. So all those stuff we have learned. Next we are going to see is a lot of Hive query language. That's where I'm going to show you how to do the join, how to process the data, all those things we are going to see. And then we are also going to see about the details about the partitioning, bucketing, and all those stuff. Okay, so what I'm going to explain you now is like how this whole partitioning and bucketing, these are the two important concepts we have with Hive. Whenever you will go for like an interview or something, they are going to ask, do you know what is partitioning, what is bucketing, right? So now we are going to understand about that, what is basically the partitioning and what is bucketing. Okay. First, I will tell you partitioning. Okay, so I'm sharing this stuff, guys, about the partitioning. Okay, so before I go and tell about the partitioning, let's understand once more, right, how the data will happen, load will happen, right? So whenever you have a basically the Hive table that's get created, so you will have this particular structure called user Hive warehouse, and then a folder will get created for the DB name.
Okay, and okay, and then inside this the file will come. So like file1.txt, right? This is the way how the data is going to be loaded in this particular table. So whenever we load the data in this particular or any table, what happens? The data will get loaded like this way: user, Hive, warehouse, database name, table name, and the file 1.txt, right? If the file 1.txt is the data which we specified to load that. Okay, now like suppose like the question which I think Muhammad you had, right? If we load another file, what will happen, right? So in that case, what will happen? Suppose if the first day you did a load of file 1.txt by the map reduce output, next day another file comes and you have this file 2.txt. Okay, then the third day you know this file 3.txt. So like that way file will get you know appended into this folder location called user, Hive, warehouse, database name, and table name, and inside that you will have the set of the files that will get created, right? Like this one. Now assume that these files, right? For example, we just took 3 lines or 4 lines of the file. Now you think this is a kind of a monthly cycle, or you know the cycle which runs the huge volume of the data, and data maybe you can think of you know like this file 1.txt data. All the transaction, all the recharge done by you know by all the customer in the January month, right? Now, if you have another table, the next load that is for the Feb, and similar way you have for March, right? So like that way the data is right. You can have like as many you want, right? So like this way the data set is getting loaded in this table. Now. So this is the way how you store the data, right? Now suppose if you want to read the data from this table now. Now suppose if you want to do something, select the table, whatever the table you have, and where something like month equal to some month you are going to specify, right? Not equal to means some month you are going to give. Now tell me, based on your understanding till now, right, the way you have understood about this one. So we know that this file it was for the January month, but Hadoop will not know, right? So it will just see that, okay, file 1.txt, file 2.txt, 3 and 4 is there. Now suppose if Hadoop has to, Hive has to read this particular file, let's take the example of month because that generally helps people to understand this concept easily, right? So just assume that you have a, monthly cycle, that's a batch cycle, and every month first it runs the data and it dumps the data in a Hive table. So every month it will create a, this particular file and it will store inside this location next month. So like this process you did it for like whole 1 year kind of thing. Now once the data is available, now you want to do certain kind of analysis on this data, and that's basically you want to do select a star. You're looking for a particular data set, so like in the January if you're running this particular ad campaign or something, and you want to see how the people behave or how the people subscribe for that particular offer or the ad, right? So now tell me, if you have to do this one, right, what do you guys think, how the Hive will get the data? Will it read the data just from file 1.txt? Will Hive have the intelligence, or it will scan through all the data from this table and then it will give you the output? Are you guys clear with my question? Is the question clear? So all the files will be scanned because it's, okay, yeah. So that's the way Hive is all the files, Chandra. Yes, scan all files for sure. It will go through all files. Yeah, correct. Right. So that's the way Hive is going to read the data. Now assume that these files are like huge files. Like you know, suppose Rohit said scan all. Yeah. So like suppose if these files are like 10 GB or you know 12 GB files, huge files are there, right? Going through all the files, you will get the output. There is no doubt about that. But then it's going to take the time. Now, instead of that, you know, storing the file in this particular way, if we know that whenever anybody is going to basically analyze this recharge table, always they are going to do for a particular month. Now, when I'm telling, if we know that a statement is very important, because if we know that this table is going to be queried in such a way that where the user is going to put this kind of condition where the month is equal to month, in that particular stuff, what we can do is, instead of storing our data like this particular way, whenever we will store the data inside this table, instead of having this file 1.txt, I will have a folder created that's basically will be for month, which will say that if month equal to January, then store some data inside that. Means only January data. Okay. Similar way, I know that how many months it's going to be there, right? So I am going to set up a folder like this way. If month is Feb, I will only have the Feb data inside this. Right. Similarly for March. Okay. Now, if we know this one there, that this is the way how the table is going to query, what we can do is, we can use this particular way of the storing the data. So we can create a folder for each month, and inside that folder I only store the January data, Feb data, or the March data. So this is called partitioning. Now if I go and run the same SQL what we have run here, if you run here in this particular stuff, what it will do is it see that okay, month is equal to Jan, so in that case it will come here, traverse this particular folder structure, it will find month equal to Jan, and it will just consider this particular data set to serve your query, whatever query you want. It will ignore rest of the stuff, right? So that way it's going to basically give you the faster response compared to do like doing the full table scan and then getting the January record, right? So are you guys able to see this, that if you store the data in this particular way or you rearrange the data in this particular way, your SQL is going to run faster because you have reduced the input data size which it has to consider to basically give you the output data size. Is it clear? So that's the way the concept of this partitioning works, right? So it's basically how you arrange the data inside. Now the next question will be how to basically create the partition and all. That's what I'm going to show you, how to create the partition, but this is the concept which you have to understand in terms of the partitioning. So basically you should know, Pradeep, means how to store the data, but along with that you should also know how you are going to consume the data. Because until you know that your user is going to query your table in this particular way, you will not be able to provide this particular optimization, right? So like suppose if you arranged your table assuming that the user is always going to put month equal to Jan. Now instead of month, suppose the user put something like this way, right? Where geo equal to something like India. I'm just giving that. In that case, if you have arranged your data in this particular way, like month equal to Jan Feb, in this case again you are going to do the whole table scan, because geo equal to India, it may come in the Jan, it may come in Feb and March, right? So it's very important whenever you are going for partitioning, you should ask first the user or whoever you're the DA or business analyst who is going to use this table, that how you are going to basically consume this table or what kind of the SQL you are going to run. If they are able to provide you that particular information, you can assure them that okay, we are going to basically give you a table which will work in a faster way. If that information is not there, generally people what they do is then generally your Hive tables will be partitioned on the date range, right? So that's like one of the common way you can do that, but then that may not be optimal if the users are using all these kind of like other columns for filtering the data. Okay, so that's the concept we have related to the partitioning. Now since we understood about the partitioning, let me understand one more related concept here, that's basically called about the bucketing. So now the next question what we have is about the next concept we have is about the bucketing. Okay. So when we talked about the partitioning, what we are telling that whenever you store, whenever you create a table, then you ask your users, okay, which column you are going to query the data, and the user is always going to tell that, okay, I'm going to query this table on in a particular column, And based on that, you are going to basically put that column as the partitioning column, and those many, how many distinct value you have for that particular column, those many number of the folders it's going to create. Like for month, it is going to create 12 folders, and your data will be arranged like that. Now, the next concept which you have is related to the bucketing. Now, suppose if you have a transaction table, right? Now, if you have a transaction table and you are creating a Hive table on top of that, you asked your user that, hey, tell me how you are going to query this particular table. And the response you get is that anytime, if I have to look to this table, always I am going to filter the data based on the transaction ID. Right? So that will be like where the transaction ID is equal to A or B. One of the user may have this particular requirement. Now think of a transaction, table which is having around, millions of the transactions which you have stored in this. Now, if you go ahead and create the partition based on the transaction ID, what will happen? You will have like basically for each transaction, you will have one folder that's get created. There is no doubt your query will run faster because you have your data arranged in each folder, but then it's going to create a lot of overhead to Hive in terms of maintaining those folders and rearranging the data. Yeah, it's going to be huge file system that's going to create moment, right? So in that case, what you are going to do is you are going to use the different concept. That concept is called bucketing, where you have a large number of the distinct value for a column. So instead of partitioning that particular column, you will go with something called the bucketing. Even you can go together partitioning and bucketing. That's like the advanced usage of that. But right now I'm trying to tell you like which scenario the bucketing works, right? So now in bucketing, what you will do that is you know that this transaction is having like millions of values it's going to have. So instead of storing all the data in different table, you will tell that, okay, I'm going to create 10 different buckets. So you will tell how many buckets. So bucketing is just like, how many different storage you are going to create. So you will identify that, okay, I'm going to cluster by my table by 10 buckets. Once you identify that, what you will do is you will create for each transaction ID, you will create something called hash value. Okay. So how you will create, like generally like one of the example of hash value will be like creating hash is like just using the modulo function. So you can have whatever transaction ID is there, take the modulo by 10, you will get a number out of that. So whatever it may be, 0 to 9, right? 0 to 9, some number you will get. So based on that number, you will decide which particular bucket this particular transaction will go. So now suppose if I have created multiple buckets here, right, like 0, 1, 2, so I will have around 10 buckets that I'm going to create. Now for each transaction ID, I'm going to calculate this hash, the modulo value, whatever the number it returns. So like if this is the first one, the number return is the 3, so I'm going to put it here. So it will be like 0 to 9, so in this case 0, 1, 2, so it is going to be 2, right? So if the next value which I am processing, it returns the value as 1, I am going to put it here. The next value, if you're going to return value as 4, I'm going to put it here. So like that way you are going to arrange the data. Now suppose if the fourth value which you tell, it's again emit the value as 2, so it's going to come into the same table, right? So that's way now you arrange the data. You don't arrange all the input record into separate folder, but instead of one folder, whoever have the same hash value, it will go inside the same folder structure. So that way again you rearrange the data. Now whenever you will give the transaction ID, again you are basically going to arrange your data in this particular format where user Hive database name, table name, and inside that you are going to have one structure where you will have all the data for the transaction which have the hash value as 3, right? Similar way 2, 1, 4, 5, like that way you are going to arrange the data. So this way again you will be basically able to reduce this subset of the data which will get queried whenever you are reading this table, and you will get a basically a faster performance. But
Only thing what you have to understand here is the partitioning, where you have the less number of distinct value, bucketing, where you have the large number of the distinct values. So in that case, the bucketing will work better. Okay, and you can always use these two together as well. Like you can have a table that's getting partitioning as well as having bucketing. So the logic of bucket selection is same as the selecting the. You have there the concept of partitioning here. It is mostly yeah. So similar kind of thing. Yeah, hash value you are going to create that. Okay. So is this clear, guys? The partitioning and the bucketing. Are you guys good with this one? Okay. Okay. And from this slide, guys, you are going to answer one interview question in case if you are going to have for a Hadoop or Hive interview. What is the difference between partitioning and the bucketing? And then you can explain in this depth and you should be done. Okay. Basically, now come back to the slide, guys. So partitioning, like how the data is stored in SDFS, grouping the data based on some column and can have one or more column for the partitioning. Bucketing, or sometimes it's called clustering also. In fact, you whenever you create a bucket, you define something called cluster by, and basically divides further into buckets and based on some other column, and uses generally for like data sampling or some quickly you want to know kind of the data, you can read from each bucket and you can get the required data set. So partition means dividing the table into different parts based on the value of the column on which you are partitioning. Example is like the date column. That's like one of the widely used. So this is going to make it faster to do the query on the slice of the data, because you are basically reducing the data set which you are going to process to get the output. So that's why the partitioning basically increases the query response which you run on top of Hive. And partition key is the one which is going to determine how the data is going to be stored inside the folder structure which you have for a particular table. And each unique value of the partition key will define the partition of the table, like each month, Jan, Feb, and month, right? So you are going to have 12 partitions. So similarly, like if you have a geo, each geo will have its own folder structure, and inside that you will have the value stored for that particular partition. Right, so and partitions are named after dates for convenience. Generally, people will use that. Whenever you are talking about the Hive, right, all the Hadoop concept which you learned earlier about the, like, you know, distributing the data, having the three-way replication, all are going to hold true in case of this as well. So, whenever the data is getting divided into a partition column, the data will be replicated internally by the name node into three different machines. So there is no change in that particular stuff, because Hadoop write is a write operation, whether Hive writes or your MapReduce program writes or you create a file, all that write is going to have the similar kind of structure for the storage. Did that answer your question, Vivek? Okay. In Teradata Oracle, can we also create partition on the range and case also? Yeah. Here, it's not on the range, but on the column value, it supports, because it creates the structure here internally. Buckets, right, to give the extra structure of the data, you have these buckets that will get created, and sometimes it becomes if you have like user ID, and if you want to query on the user ID, so in that case, like you can always create the buckets, and your different user ID will get grouped together as one bucket, as in the next in another bucket, and you can just query that subset of the data and get the output. If you have the joins on the table and you're including those columns, so in those cases also it helps to basically get you data faster. Okay, so now we have to see about like some of the examples here about more about the hands-on sessions. I think rest of the slides what you have here is more towards the hands-on slide. I don't think we have all these concepts. So what I'm going to do, guys, here is I'm going to show you all this stuff, right, joining the two tables. I will just quickly go through. Okay. So I will show you all these hands-on exercise. So we'll create a database, which is the database retail. So we'll create one database here. And inside this, we'll see all these, the transaction data getting stored, partition, and bucketing.
Let me switch over to the virtual machine which we have. Okay. If I want to create this database my retail, tell me what should be the command I should use. If I want to create this database my retail, what should be the command? So now I'm going to use you guys command here, create database. Yeah, so always guys, you have to terminate it by a colon, right? If you don't do that, Hive will not accept that. Like if I do this create database my retail, it will keep asking, right? This colon you have to terminate. So this database has been created. Okay, that's not significant. Like you understand the command, but just to make you say that always terminate with the colon. Okay. So now you have this particular database created called my retail. So now what I will do is I will use this particular database to create rest of the table which we are going to discuss here. So what I will do is I will do huge and my data. So instead of every time putting like database name dot column name, yeah. So now I get use my detail. Yeah, we can do that. Okay, so it's done. So now whatever I will do here, it's going to be created in this table. Now let me get the data set which I will use it here to basically load in this table so that I can show you. Okay, let me get the data here. It should be available on the virtual machine itself. Go back. Okay. Transaction here. Okay, so this is the data set which I am going to basically load into a table. So okay, let's first understand like what this data is, right? So this data, I hope you guys remember this data set. Do you guys remember which particular example we saw this data set? This is a transaction data set which we saw. Okay, yeah, in the join we saw that, right? So this is the data set we have, right? So you have basically the transaction ID. Then you have a transaction date. So these are the column transaction date, and then you have the customer number. So you have multiple customers, so customer number you have. Then this is the amount which they have transacted. Then what you have is you have the category, which category they bought all these equipment. And then you have the product, what kind of the product they had. Then what you have is the city. And then you have the state, and then what kind of the expenditure, it's like credit, saving, and all this stuff. Okay. So that's the way how this whole data set is arranged here, right? So what we are going to do is we are going to create a table that will basically have this particular data that will be stored in the table. Once that is there, we will run some SQL, and then we will basically create the partition and bucketing on this table. So the data set is clear to everybody what the data set we are going to have. This is the data set, and it is going to have certain set of the columns that we are going to use it here. Okay, it's clear. Okay, so now what we are going to do, I'm going to create table. So all I will do is like create table, I will give it table name, and then I will give these columns as a name and the data type, and that's all. And then I will load this data inside the table. So that's what I'm going to do as a first step to create a table inside this. Okay, so let me take the take the definition of this table here. So here I'm going to basically do it. Okay. So here what I'm doing guys here is I'm creating a table. So I'm doing create table, and then the table I'm creating is called transaction records, and then I'm giving all these stuff: transaction number, date, customer number, amount, category, product, city which they were, state, and what kind of the expenditure, right? So there are some data type we have given here based on the data we have, and then I'm telling the row format delimited fills terminated by comma, right? So this is the way my data is going to be there inside the file which I will load, and then store as a text file. So this is again optional statement. By default it will always store in the text file. In Hive you have other options, like you can store your data in sequence file and even RC file and all this stuff. Hit enter, the table will be created. Now if you want to see the tables, you do show tables, it will show the table has been created. Now in the back end, if you want to look what happened here, so if you come back here, if you do a user Hive warehouse, what you will see is there are some tables. Okay, control L, sorry guys, it was LSLRS. So if you come here, user Hive DB, you will have a database that's created called My Retail DB, right? So this is the database which we are interested in. Okay, so now what we will do is we will do Hadoop fs hyphen ls and then My Retail DB. So here you have this transaction record, this the table got created. If you do inside this, there will be nothing right now inside this because you don't have any data inside this table. So right now what we will do is we will load this particular data set which we have stored here, transaction records, that into this table which we have just now created called transaction records. How we will do that? What will be the statement there? So like assume this file is there, it's called transaction1.txt. this is the file which we are using inside this location. Where do you have, okay, so let me take this properties. And let me see who able to answer that. Okay, so this is the location inside this. I have the table called suppose txns1.txt. Okay, now I want to load inside this table transaction records. Can you guys help me with the command which I should use to load this particular file in this table where the schema is this? Right, so this way you can basically do a quick recap whatever we learned yesterday, how we will load the data inside this table. So we can use this load data. Yeah, cool. Yeah, load data. I will use from the local itself. No, I'm not moving it as HDFS in path. In case if you load the data from HDFS, guys, just you have to remove this local. You will do load data in path and give the HDFS location. So that's all you have to do. Okay, take this one. txt, okay, and then into table and let's have this one transaction records. Load data local in path, give this particular input file into table transaction records. Just hit enter, your data has been loaded. Now come back here and you do the same command. Now you will see the file will be available inside HDFS called transaction1.txt, right? So that's the way you are able to load the data inside this table. Good. So now in case if you like, if I now you saw the whole structure, if at any time if you want to do basically see the table detail, you can always do describe and you can see the whole the structure of the table. If you want more extended and formatted, you can do anything like that. Now, once the table is created, you can do all sort of operations. Generally, what you do in the SQL, you can do in this particular table. And the thing which you will observe here, compared to what we saw, like the same data set, if we process using the MapReduce, it becomes challenging. Now, with the help of the Hive or the SQL interface which you use, it will be much easier. Like suppose if you want to count how many number of records, you just to select count. Start from transaction records. Right. So it will launch a MapReduce job and it will show you the output. it has around, okay, 50,000 records. Okay, so it has around 50,000 entry in this table, so it shows you that. Okay, you have the option to basically do the silent execution here, like unmute these, all these number. But for now, since you are learning it, I will tell you, like, let it be as it is, the setting, so that you can see how the whole process works and all this stuff. Right. And now, whenever you run this, guys, Hive SQL, right, it, since it runs the MapReduce job, so if you come back here and if you go to the job tracker, you will see all this stuff is coming as a MapReduce job. Right. So just now we ran the select counter star from transaction record table. You see here it launched a MapReduce job, and that's where it passes. Okay. So it's a complete MapReduce job what you have. That's what I'm like. Now let's run some more SQL on top of this. So let's describe the table so that we know. Now let's do something. Like suppose you want to do a group by, right? Generally we do it. Like, so you do select. Let's select category, then you do something called sum, and that's basically amount, each category what is the amount which is spent, from this table called transaction records, and then you do group by whichever the category you want. Right. This can be like one of your requirement, right, where you have the huge data set, you want to do some group by statement from a table, and then you get, so select category, then you do a sum, like for each category whatever the amount is spent, and from the table, and you do a group by, hit enter. It will launch a MapReduce job, and it will do this calculation and show the output. You see here, for each the category, it's basically able to show you like what is the amount that's worth on it. Now suppose if you have the multiple output, now if you want to restrict it, like okay, I have these main number of category, I want to see just few records, so instead of all the thing, you want to something like limit something like 7 records, you want to see that. You can either, the reason why I'm showing you the limited stuff, because guys, always you will have a huge table, so always don't forget to use the limit, otherwise you have to terminate. So you can do limit 1, 2 and those, so that you can see the sample record, and based on that you can do the further processing. Okay, so you can see that now instead of dumping everything, it will just dump you the limited like 6, 7 records, and that you can take it to basically the further processing. Okay, so now let me tell you like how to create a partition table. So this was like one of the table which we created, and this is the table which we created. Now suppose if you want to create a partition table here, so what we can do is like we can based on the category just now we saw, right, like suppose if you want to create a partition on this particular column, so in that case what you will do is, so you have this category, like suppose if you pick this column that you are going to partition your data. So whenever you create a table, you tell that, okay, this is, so there are two ways you can create the partitioning, guys. One is like dynamic partitioning, one is static partitioning. In case of dynamic partitioning, when you load the data, the table data will get partitioned. In case of static partitioning, it is like you create a table structure, you create a partition, and then you move the data inside that. So here what we are going to do is we are going to first look the dynamic partitioning. So we are going to create a table, and there we are going to tell that, okay, this table will be partitioned based on this particular column called category. Okay,
And then if you want to create a bucket, you can tell like, you know, maybe I will bucket all the data set based on the state. So you can have, you know, the buckets created, call something by the statement called cluster by, and then you give the column, which column you want to basically create, and then the number of buckets you want to create. So in our case, we'll give like 10 buckets, arrange all the state there. And then while you load the data in this table, you can use some temporary table to load the data, and from there, it will basically create the partition and then load the data. Let me show you like how you will create the table here. Okay, so take this. So what we are doing is we are creating a table. We are calling a table with transaction by category. So we are basically partitioning this table. Then we are giving the columns which all we want to keep inside this table. And that column which you want to create as a partition, you don't need to specify either column schema. So that you have to always give to the partition column. So that will not part of the schema here. So it will automatically, since you're in the path, it will have it. So you do partition by, and then you give the column in which you want to create the partition. Then you do cluster by, and then how many number of the buckets. So this is the way how you create the bucket. You specify the column which you want to create the buckets, and then tell how many number of the buckets you want to arrange the data. Then row format delimited field stores as a text file. So that's the way you create a partition and the bucketing table. Hit enter. The table has been created. Now, once the table has been created, what we'll do is we'll load the data inside this table, and then we will see that how the data will get rearranged in this particular table. So as of now, if you see, I will be keep showing you guys side by side this stuff as well, so that you can understand the concept which I discussed to you about the partitioning. So if I go and do this myretail.db, I will have one more table that's get created here called transaction by category. If I do Hadoop, you will basically see no data. Now what I'm going to do is, so as of now, when you created the partition, it didn't create anything, guys. And the reason why is because we didn't have the data here, what is the category data. So it doesn't know like what subfolder it has to create here now. Once we load the data, it will know this particular stuff. Now, since you are doing this dynamic partitioning, what you have to do is you have to set certain values here whenever you do that. So you do it something, set command, set hive dot execute dot dynamic partition dot mode equal to non-strict. Then you do something called dynamic partition equal to true, and then you want to enforce bucketing, you can do that as execute hive okay. So basically you set all these parameters. So what these parameters guys do is, one is to enable this dynamic partitioning, so set hive execute dynamic partitioning, that's true. Then to bucketing, it you're setting true. What this partition mode non-strict means is, whenever you create a partition table, you have an option to restrict what kind of the SQL that's going to run. Like suppose if you have created a partition table based on the like category or maybe the month, but the user is going to query this table always based on the geo. So in that case, basically overall your the SQL performance is going to go down because you are not using the correct column for querying the data. So to avoid such scenario, what you can do is you can put it in a strict mode. So if you put it in a strict mode, if you run a SQL and it doesn't have that where clause, the partition column which you have used in the where, it will not run on that, right? So in case of the bigger table, you can just avoid to have this full table join. In our case, we are not putting a strict, so you can run any kind of SQL here. Once you do all this setting, what you can do is you can insert the data into this table from the table which you have created, the transaction records, the table which we have created. From there, you can now insert the data inside this table, because like now you are reading the data from one table and inserting the data in transaction record by category table. So by using the simple SQL stuff, you will be able to insert the data inside this table. So what you do here now is you now insert the data in this table. So you tell like read the data from the transaction record table and then insert into transaction by category, where we have done the partitioning based on the category, and we are inserting the data in these columns. Okay, hit enter. It will start dumping the data inside this table. Transaction category table is already a partition table, so it will keep rearranging the data in such a way that your data will be stored inside different buckets as well as the partition. Cool. So a lot of stuff happened here. So let's see what we are interested in. Let's see what happened our end, right? So now you see here, earlier we had this transaction by category table. Now when we ran the SQL here, what we see here is it has created user Hive warehouse DB transaction by category, and for each category it has created a folder here. Dancing, exercise, games, gymnastic, indoor game, right? Jumping, outdoor, right? So now if you go any of these, like if I go here, you will see the further data that will be basically grouped into different buckets. So that will be those number of files that get created called games. And you see the data is stored now in 00, 01, 02, like 10 buckets will be created here. So you see here from 0 to 9 to these 10 buckets. That's where the data is now created and is stored here inside. Okay, so that's the way the data in the backend is. Now, if you go back and look any particular folder, like if you take like this one, Hadoop, office-cat, and this particular stuff, it will show you the data. See here, there is no the column which you have done this one holy stuff, this partition, that particular data doesn't get stored, but whenever you will run a SQL on top of it, that particular category will automatically come there. Now at any point, suppose if you want to read anything from this table, right, so you can do anytime if you want to do select a star. So whenever you do this, you can see always all the city name, state, everything will come here, right? So although the data is not stored in the file, but while reading that, it will traverse that particular path and it will automatically give you the complete information here.
Okay, so we saw about the partitioning, we saw about the bucketing. Okay, so let's see some more stuff, right? So let's do some simple stuff like when we talk about the table, we always do want to do the join kind of thing. So let me show you like how to how in the Hive performs the join. Okay, so let me show you the join. So I have to get the data set for that. So okay, let me see here. Imply an email .txt. Okay, so suppose if we have a data set something like this, right? So that's like, so I'm just going to demo you right how the join works in Hive. Okay, so suppose if you have a data set that's basically the employee data set, and that's what you have here. It's a comma separated field, and it has the details like the name of the employee, the salary, right, and then the city, right, which city they belong to. Similarly, you have the email. So that's again the name and then the email account which they have. Now based on this name, so the name is going to be the key which is common between both the table. So we are going to join these two data set, employee and the email, based on this column called name. And then we'll see like how the overall stuff works and how the whole join stuff, simple join, it works with the Hive. Okay, so with this, let's create a quick table here. So we'll do create table. Let's give the name as employee. So we are creating a table called employee. Then give name as a string. Then salary, let's give float, or int, you can give anything. Okay, let's float if it is a bigger number. Okay, and then city, again that's string, right? This is a simple table definition you can put. So you are creating a table called employee, and you are giving three columns: name, salary and city, and for each column you are specifying what should be the data type. Then row format fields, terminated by comma. So what we are doing here is we are creating a table called employee, and that's that. What kind of table it is? Is it managed table or external table which I am creating here? Okay, so it's a managed table. Okay, great. Good. So I'm creating a table called employee, and the name, salary, city, and the roof. Okay, hit enter. The table has been created. Now what I can do is I can load the data in this table. So load data local in path, and then I can give the location of this particular file, email, employee.txt. Take it here, copy, demo, and the file name is emp.txt. Okay. Enter table. Call employee. Data has been read. Now let's create another table. That's basically the table which we are going to use it for email, right? So let's create a table. So create table and do it something called mail ID. Have the name as a string. Okay, and then email as well as a string. Let me copy the scene where I don't want to type it here again, so I will just take it and row format again. The table has been created. I'll just bring back this load data local in path instead of emp.txt. Now I can do emin, I think. It should be hive demo. Email.txt. Enter table instead of imply. We'll do it in email ID. Okay, so the data has been loaded here. Can the author's user access the tables created by an user? Generally, yes, is right. So, in case if you have like permissions, you can open change the permission as well. So, Hadoop supports this Linux command, Hadoop fs hyphen chmod, and then you can give like 766 or whatever permission you want. So, in case if you are, I'm not sure if you're running into any issue with the thing, you can use this change mode command to change the user. Okay, so the table has been created. Now, if you do a select a star. Imply. You will see this one, and similarly, if you do mail ID, you will see the mail. Okay, both the tables have been created now. Now, what you can do is you can join these two tables, and then you can do all different kind of join operation. One thing in Hive, what it supposes supports is called something called EQJoin. So you can always do the EQJoin in Hive, and it will be able to run that. So now let me clean this. And let me have this table. Okay, so these two. Now let me go ahead and select. For that, I need the definition of the table. Okay, so let me clean it again. Describe. Okay, and describe. Okay, so now what we are going to do is we are going to join these two tables, right? So, how to do the join? I think most of you should be familiar with this. So, do select. A dot name, so you are selecting the name. A dot city, you are selecting the city, and then A dot. So you are selecting the name, city, and the salary, and then from other, let's select the email. Right? From employee. Okay. Join it with mail ID that's on the B, and then you give the key on which you want to do on A dot name equal to B dot name. Okay, so this is a simple join statement you're doing. So select A dot name, A dot city, A dot salary. So these are the three columns you are selecting from the table A. A is like the employee table, and then B dot email you are selecting from the other table, that's basically the mail ID column, and you're telling to do a join. And basically when you just specify the join, it's going to do something called the inner join, and it will give you the output. And the join is going to happen in the column name and name from A dot name and B dot name. Okay, so now it's going to run the MapReduce job, and it's going to do this join. Okay, so you see here, whatever the matching records we had for those records, along with the name, city, and the amount, it's also able to get the email address. Is this clear, guys? Hello? Okay, great. Now let's go back and see some more join. So this was like one of the example of the inner join. Now suppose if you want to do some like only you want to select all the employee from the employee table and only the matching whatever entry is there on the B, right? So you can do something called the left outer join. So Hive supports that as well. Okay. Left outer join, main idea. So similar way you can support all other stuff as well, guys. So like it supports all left outer join, right outer join, full outer join, all those stuff it's supported here. So based on your query requirement, you can use that. Okay, so this is something, guys, we did it for like, also basically the idea was to give you, kind of, expose like how the Hive can handle, and it has a SQL kind of interface, so you can do all those group by partitioning, clustering, join, right, select, aggregate functions, sum, average, all those kind of stuff you can run on the Hive, and it will be able to give you the output. Okay. So now let's go back to the slide and see how we are progressing on the slide, and then we'll come back. Okay. We saw this create database, then use database, then create tables, all those stuff we saw. Then external table, we saw this concept yesterday. So where we can do create external table, we give the external table name and whatever the definition of the column, and then you can give the location where exactly the date will be located, and based on that it will start exposing this particular data which is in this location inside this table. So the good thing with the external table, guys, that Hive will not delete the table or the HDFS files when the table are dropped. So this will leave the table untouched, and only the metadata about this table will be deleted. So that's the big thing with the external table. You save basically the file, or you don't give the ownership of the file to Hive. So only you can read the data, but whenever it comes to basically, giving the ownership, so that ownership will be remain to the folder where it is stored. You can always refer the data set. Load data, as you have, right, the command like load data local in path, and give the path wherever your data is located, and override into table, and then give the table name, right? So don't go by this these things, guys, because it is the one single command you have, somehow it got typed here. Okay. Then describe, you can do describe and the table name, and it will describe the details about the table. Okay. Now running the SQL, you can run all kind of, all these kind of the SQL, like it will do select count star, you can do the aggregation, you can do the grouping, group by, although stuff you can run on the Hive tables, and it will be able to give you the output. Okay, then also like if you have data available in one table and you want to insert into another table, so you can do insert output, like insert override table. You can give the table name and you can select a star from the other table, so that way you can do that. If you want to output your table into some like local directory, like if you want to dump the data from the table inside the directory, you can do that. Insert override, and you give the directory name where you want to store the data. And then you can select from the table. So in that way, what will happen is it will read the data from the table. It will store that on the file system. So like these are like the SQL stuff which you can do on top of Hive. So these are like some examples. You can, like, based on your requirement, like different formatting of the date, you know, the string, right? So you can write, you know, SQL. There are a lot of the functions available in the Hive which you can use it to basically meet all your custom requirements. Okay. So again, as we talked, right? So with the help of Hive, again, you can use all this, like, you know, the healthcare example. You can bring the data all through the Hive table, and then you can run some kind of encryption on each column data, and then you can store the data back inside the Hive, and you will be able to basically now analyze the data in an encrypted format. So all those kind of things now are possible with the help of Hive. Right. So with this, like, one thing in it should be by now, right? Since you are now, you know, learning about the different tool, although we are going to run a few more stuff in the Hive, but slowly by now, right, you should have a fair understanding about the whole Hadoop environment, where you have seen the multiple tool and you have seen the uses of each of these tool, and based on this, you should be able to now take a call, like, how to design the whole, you know, the Hadoop stuff, or which particular tool you should select to do a this kind of the data processing stuff inside inside Hive. Are you guys getting this confidence, guys, now that, you know, the your knowledge based on about the Hadoop different tools? Just now, like, we were talking about the managed table, but, you know, external table, Hive, pig, as well as partitioning, bucketing. So are you guys getting that sense that, you know, slowly you're having some kind of the better understanding or the learning inside the Hadoop ecosystem? Okay. So similarly, this join statement, you can do that, right? Like, joining the two tables, you can join these two tables with the help of, like, join statements, which we saw just now, right? So you have two different tables. If you want to bring any kind of the data set after joining the table, you can get that. Okay, so I think this basically brings towards the end of this module. So we are going to see some more concept. I think somebody asked about the custom mapper and all. I'm going to tell you that in a bit. Right. So basically, go ahead and attempt all this week 5, the exercise using the LMS. Run Hive on the cloud. Do the setup in case if you have not done that, and then execute all this. Data set is also available, so you can do all these exercises there, and you should be good with the Hive. With this, guys, I will wrap up today's class and then see you guys tomorrow. Okay, bye.